a lot of people here, that's for sure. All right, so today I'm going to talk about screenwriting and how I learned about it, and a little bit of what I wrote and what I took inspiration from, and so who helped me and what I used. It's a lot. It's about screenwriting. Okay, so filmmaking versus screenwriting, first of all. Screenwriting is a script. You write the story for a movie. Filmmaking is far more broad. It's like directing, principal photography, casting, production design, editing. Mike did scoring and he was great. So stuff like that is filmmaking. That all goes into making a movie or a film or whatever you want to call it. And it requires a ton of different professions, but it all starts with a script, with a story, with an idea, stuff like that. So that's what I'm here to talk about. Okay, so there are lots of things you want to think about when you're going to write a script. First, of course, is the plot. Like, what is the story about, and like, what conflict pushes it forward? Because a story without conflict is pointless, it's nothing. And then you want to think about your characters. Like, who is the story about? And what is their struggle, their motivation, or their point? What is their conflict? How does the conflict affect them? And then setting the scene, like where is the story set, and how does the setting affect the progress of the story? And then there's scene and story pacing, which is it's more difficult. It's one of the more difficult aspects because you have to think about how will you connect the plot and weave it together, and it's kind of difficult to keep people from getting bored unless it's, you know, a movie full of explosions, which generally good movies aren't. And then there's dialogue, which is my favorite part. I love writing dialogue. But it's like, how will a character's feelings come across through the way they talk and their interactions with other characters? And then a story can have a meaning. It doesn't have to. It can be entertainment. But it can also be meant to send a message about a certain social issue or stuff like that. Okay. So the first step is, you know, it's hard. So it's sort of like what Neil Armstrong said, it's one small step but one giant leap. And there's nothing more daunting than a blank page. I know this from experience. It's difficult to look and see nothing there and be like, wow, what am I going to put here? And then knowing that you have 39 more pages to fill after that, it's difficult. Alex, stop filming me. And you may not have a concrete idea until far into your script. Your story can change, your characters can evolve differently than you may have been expecting, and that's fine. If you don't end up where you thought you were going to go, that's, you know, as long as you're happy with what your characters went through, how the story played out, that's fine. It doesn't always have to go according to plan. And writer's block is not only common, but it's expected. I went through it a lot. Just sitting, staring at my computer, being like, what the hell am I going to put here? And, you know, that can be scary sometimes when you have a deadline, or when you don't know what your character's going to do next, what action is coming up, stuff like that. And you don't want to just fill your story with fluff, because then the story becomes boring. And so that's going along with that. It's always good to outline beforehand, like, have what you want your characters to do, where they're going to go, who they'll interact with, what impact the other characters have on the story, what the conflict is, setting, how that affects the characters, stuff like that. And gather research beforehand for a topic if necessary. So if you're going to write about a social issue, know about that issue. If you're going to write about a historical issue, know about that. Because if you go in completely empty-headed, it's not going to go well. Okay, so an outline is the first thing you should do. It's pretty common you do it for papers and stuff like that. The script is just a fancy paper, I guess. And so you have to formulate your ideas for your characters, who they're going to become, how they're going to change. Is it a hero's journey, or are they more, you know, detestable and stuff like that? And you can flirt with different ideas, you know. If you're going to go in with one story in mind and you don't have any wiggle room, then it's going to go poorly. You know, you've got to have, you know, different ideas, ways to, you know, you need to be flexible. And it can be a comedy, or a drama, or a documentary, or coming of age, or there's a million dramas, romance, stuff like that. And it can be a little bit of both. I think mine is a little bit of both, of a little bit of comedy and drama, stuff like that. That's just my opinion, that's up to you all to decide. And there's also adapted or original. Like, you can decide if you want to base your script off of a book, or if you want to remake a movie or something like that, or there's an original where it's a story you came up with, characters you created, stuff like that. And sort of know your strength. Like, I think that I'm better at dialogue, far better than I am with pacing and stuff like that. So I focused on making my dialogue really strong. And while I tried to work with pacing, I knew that it was something I was going to have to, you know, get better with over time. It wasn't something I could improve by sitting in the same space and, like, rethinking words and stuff like that. It's a more complicated thing because it's how the plot goes together. Okay, and then general ideas for a script. Usually it's a three-act structure. You should play with ideas. The story should unfold how your character's goals unfold, because your main character is sort of the pilot of your story. Have ambition, because if you make something that, or write something that is, you know, you're playing it safe, then, you know, people aren't going to be super excited about it and what happens in your story. And you can create the world you want your script to be in because you're writing it. So if I wanted to base my story on an alien planet full of octopus people, that's not what I did, but I could. And you can do, there's endless possibilities when writing a script because it's your story, as long as it's, you know, not plagiarized and stuff like that. And of course, think about if you're going to have a narrator or not, because that's a special type of dialogue and you need to know about that. And of course, the story unfolds differently when there is a narrator. And grab people's attention. Okay, I know I'm probably not doing it for a lot of you right now, but we're getting to the movie scene, so be ready. But anyway, strong opening, strong closing, snappy dialogue. Those are all super important to keep the plot moving, but also to keep people interested in the plot. And a question that I think a lot of screenwriters get is, should you write what you know, or should you play it safe? Like, if you want to write about something that, you know, I guess doesn't really affect you, is that a bad thing? And one of my favorite filmmakers, his name is Aaron Sorkin, he did The Social Network, he did The West Wing, he's really great. He was nominated for an Oscar last night, two of them I think actually. But anyway, he says that as long as you write with compassion and empathy, for if you're writing about a certain group of people, say like LGBTQIA people, if I were to write about that, I would need to write with empathy and compassion and understanding for them, and I would need to know what I'm talking about. I can't just go in being me and expecting, you know, to write a story about them that, you know, isn't offensive. You know, you need to write with empathy and care and stuff like that. So I think, personally, I agree with him. You don't have to play it safe, but if you're going to, you know, write something outside of your comfort zone or something that you know, then you should know what you're talking about. Okay, and now we're getting to characters. Who can relate to your main character? Because, you know, that's going to be the demographic that's probably going to be interested in your movie, so you should know that and know how to talk to them and how they act and stuff like that. And what is your character's goal? What is their purpose in the story? What do they want to achieve? And an unforgettable character always leads to an unforgettable story. That's, you know, pretty obvious. And characters always have a problem to solve. They always have a mission they're on or a goal, or, you know, in older movies, a woman to save, something like that. And characters can be good or bad. You know, you can have a lead that is a bad person. Those are, I think, very interesting movies, and I think the most interesting characters are the more complex villainous ones. And are they sympathetic or detestable? Like, can you feel for them? Do you understand what they're going through? Or do you just, you know, hate them without any remorse? And then there's secondary characters. Are they a support for your main character, or are they a foil? Do they help them along the way, or do they get in their way? And do the side characters have their own goals and intentions? And every character should have intention and an obstacle. So something they're working for, something that gets in the way. And always show that, don't tell it. Okay, so setting. Where's the place? Where's the time period? How does it impact your story? Is it for better or for worse? The way I think about it is the characters, their time period, and their setting and their place. And when Harry met Sally, they're in New York in like the 1980s. It's, you know, culture, life, yada, 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 romance. And things work out pretty well for them. And then when it's set in the 1800s and 12 Years a Slave, and the characters are black people, it does not go well for them. That is, it would be different if they were in New York City in the 1980s. So it's, setting does have a lot of impact on your story and your characters, especially in historical stories. And it can be a bottle movie, which is the one I wrote. It's a bottle movie. It takes place in one room the entire time. And movies like that are 12 Angry Men, which is about a jury. It's really good. And then Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, which is, Mr. Aldridge actually showed that to us. It's set in a house, basically, the entire time. And it's four characters just talking, basically. And then there's Free Scope, which is like Lord of the Rings. They're going through all the realms of Middle-earth. And also Lawrence of Arabia. He's obviously, you know, traveling through Arabia. Okay. And then pacing. This is where I had a lot of trouble, if I'm being honest. Each event is like a link in a chain for your story. And will the events come together? They should, because if you have things flailing off in random directions, then the story is not going to make sense in the end. And what action is going to be used to keep the story alive? Because if you just have a random scene with no purpose, and there's no, you know, culmination of it or, you know, closing for it, then it has no point. And it dies along with most of your story. And dialogue should always be purposeful, like, rather to show it, you know, naturally, like people talking naturally if they're in a relationship, stuff like that. But just having random, you know, unconnected dialogue doesn't really help the story. It sort of just weighs down the progress and halts the momentum. And page limits. This is very important. One page in a script is usually 1 minute of a movie. So my script is 40 pages long. It would technically be considered a short film because it would be probably 40 minutes long. And the time frame, like how much time does, you know, your movie cover? Like Buried, which is a movie starring Ryan Reynolds. He gets buried, he's a soldier that gets buried in the desert. It takes place over, I think, 6 hours. And then Boyhood is about, you know, a boy growing up. It takes place over 18 years. So that sort of stuff has, you know, a big effect on your script, because Barry has more time to, you know, focus on the little things and, you know, dialogue and stress in that sort of period of time. But Boyhood, being over 18 years, you have to gloss over a lot. Dialogue, my favorite part. Grammar and word choice are important. You should avoid dull words, but don't overstuff like what your characters say. They should talk, you know, how people talk, but they also shouldn't be dull or, you know, ineffective in getting their point across. And don't dilly-dally around, get to the action. Like if characters were to continually greet each other over and over and over again, that would be pointless, and it sort of delays the excitement. And there should be growth, like characters should grow from their dialogue and conversations with other characters. And believability in that is key. And soap operas are not known for their writing, like someone's a twin isn't going to show up and reveal that, you know, some crazy thing about their family. Like, it needs to be believable, something that would happen in real life, or you lose, you know, a lot for your story because it just becomes nonsense. And keep it concise. Constant monologuing is boring. It gets really boring. And you'll see in my script there's a lot of, like, I guess, longer lines that could be considered monologuing, but I try in a way to sort of make that the culmination of my story so it wasn't completely, you know, boring the entire time. It was revealing a lot about the character also. And snappy dialogue, like I said before, it works really well, but don't try and use it all the time, because people should talk how they talk, and nobody's quipping at each other time after time, all the time. And the purpose of a story is the story sending a message. Who are you writing for or to? You can write a script for a person or like to a certain group of people. And the best scripts tell a meaningful story, but they don't have to, you know? It can be, action movies, some tell stories, but like Transformers, I would consider a good movie, but it's not really a meaningful story. And there's entertainment in that. Sometimes you like to just go and have a fun time and not have to worry about the weight of a, you know, deep story. And that's understandable, but the best movies are generally the ones that tell a meaningful story. And don't try and force agendas. And I don't mean that you shouldn't, you know, if you want to write about something you care about, that you shouldn't add it into your script. But do it in a way that doesn't seem like you're jamming it down people's throats, because you know how, you know, people nowadays get offended by that. And so, like I said before, believability is key. So if you're going to send a message, make sure that it is done elegantly and it is not sort of forced upon the audience. And also, don't lose your voice, because everybody has their own unique voice. I do, you do, all y'all do. So if you write a script, try and keep that in there. Don't try and copy completely based off of what someone says. Just do your thing, okay? Have that in there, because everybody's got their own story to tell. And also, a question you should ask is, does the screenplay relate to the current social dynamic? Doesn't have to, it can. Some are more interesting when they do, some are more interesting when they don't. It depends, it's up to you. Okay, so a beginning and an end. Strong starts draw people in. I think everybody knows that. Strong endings make people glad they were drawn in. But make both resonate. Don't make them, you know, pointless, unconnected scenes in the wider story. Make them mean something within the story. And so the opening always sets the stage, and the ending brings it home. So I have two examples. The first one is from a movie called The Shape of Water. It's a great movie. Most of you might know it as the movie where a woman has sex with a fish, but it's much more than that. And the beginning is very mystifying, so I hope you enjoy it.
Perhaps I'll just warn you about the truth of these facts. and the tale of love and loss, and the monster who tried to destroy it all.
It's pretty mystifying because you don't really know why this woman is floating around in an apartment and why this man, who you don't know on a voiceover, calls her the princess without voice. And all of it has to do with the story. When he talks about the monster, you might think, oh, this fish monster thing. But as you watch the movie, your opinion on that might change. And I think that it's really, when I first saw it, it drew me into the story and I was like, well, what the hell happened? I want to know how she got to this point and what is all this stuff he talked about. And that is sort of a good way to, I guess, draw in your audience. And I tried to do that in a way. Not exactly like that. There wasn't a voiceover. It wasn't, you know, underwater, yada, yada, yada. It's my own story, but I tried to make it sort of attention grab. So I'm going to read a little bit of it. So. Alright, bear with me, it's a little long. Fade in. Interior, compact, office/bedroom, night. Jack Diamond, don't make fun of the name, it makes sense later if you read the script. But anyway, 30s. A tired and slightly emaciated man hunches over a desk, scribbling on a pad of paper. He pauses to press stained hands over his eyes and takes a deep breath. He continues writing. Dark bags hang under icy blue eyes and over 2-day-old stubble. He rips the paper from the pad, crumples it up, drops it over the edge of the desk, and continues to write. The paper falls atop a mountain of other crumpled papers spilling from a small wastebasket on the floor beside the desk chair. Jack rips out another page, wads it into a ball, and throws it against the opposite wall. The paper bounces off a faded Blade Runner poster and lands next to an overturned thermos leaking old coffee on the ink-stained, shattered carpet. Jack is still writing. On the wall behind him is a crooked corkboard with numerous and varied pen papers containing notes, post-its, and photographs. Yarn connects papers, notes in various colors and scribbles are nearly illegible. Clear image of a news article with the heading, Unknown, Tap to Helm, Paramount's Big Budget Space Drama. Jack is still writing. Next to him, atop a mountain of random paper, sits a piece of paper with a Paramount Pictures letterhead. Void is stamped near the bottom in angry red. Jack, off-screen, bingo. Interior. Interview room, camera footage day. Camera focus sharpens on Jack, slouching in a black office chair. A small microphone snakes out of his gray suit jacket and attaches to his lapel. Interviewer off screen. So that's what happened, how this whole big deal started. Jack twirls his thumbs in a circular motion. Eyes facing down, he nods in agreement. I mean, it seems a bit falsified. Dramatic, even. Jack scoffs and sits up straighter. He lifts his gaze to the camera. We prefer cinematic. B. Interviewer off screen. All right, cinematic. Why tell the story that way? B. Jack smirks slightly and looks into the camera. Well, that's the job, isn't it? Okay, so basically, what I tried to do there is sort of set up a mystery behind, you know, all the stuff you see in this guy's room, Jack's room. And the interviewer says, so that's how it happened, how this whole big deal started. That's sort of meant to be like, what's the big deal that he's talking about? And so my goal was, especially with that last line, was to sort of hint at what Jack was doing and what his job is. And so then we're going to talk about ending. So like I said, making things resonate. So my example is from Sunset Boulevard. Basically, it's about a former famous actress in silent films who desperately wants to become famous again, basically, get back into the film game. And she's older, and she meets a screenwriter who she sort of falls in love with, and she wants him to sort of help her with her screenplay so she can become a big star again. And she falls in love with him, stuff happens, he sort of tells her, it culminates in a scene that he tells her she's not going to be a star anymore, so she murders him and he drowns in a pool. And so this scene is her under arrest with the police, but the news crews are there. So basically what she thinks is happening is they're filming a movie, that she's back in the movie business, so this is how it goes.
This is his statue of the palace.
Oh, yes. Down below, they're waiting for the princess. I'm ready.
All right. Cameras. So they were turning after all. Those cannons. Life, which can be strangely merciful, had taken pity on Norma Desmond. The dream she had clung to so desperately had enfolded her.
I think it's pretty tragic. A lot of people think it's dark, and I would agree, but more to the sense that it is sad. And so my character, in a way, is sort of based off of her, because he's this director, in quotations, that wrote a script, but basically, during production, he was abusive to his cast, he was rude, he was a little unhinged because he cared so much about making this movie that it ended up being shut down. And so he's, like her, still holding on to his dream of making that movie, and so I took a lot of inspiration from that in that scene particularly. Alright, so my script is, it took a while to come up with a title, but I settled on one. It's called Hitchcock Wishes, and it's that way because the character, Jack, wishes he was like Alfred Hitchcock, who's this famous movie director, but he also, and he says this in the movie, he says, Hitchcock wishes he had a tenth of my charm, and he says that because he's so egotistical that he thinks he's like one of the greatest of all time. And so that's sort of where it's sort of a double meaning for the title. It took a while to come with the title. I'm not totally sold on it, but you know, I like that it has two meanings. Okay, and so I'm going to talk about, I did not know writing could be so hard. I kind of was expecting it to be easier. And I'll talk about what I'm proud of, what I'm not proud of, where I started, where I'm in, and where I finished. And so when I first applied for this independent study, I was like, this is gonna be a breeze. I mean, all I gotta do is write a movie. And that was, I think, summed up pretty perfectly by my brother, Teddy, who, when he saw me like frantically typing one night at like One in the morning, he called me a stupid idiot, as he normally does. And, you know, it was, I thought I was getting away with highway robbery. I thought I was, you know, here we go, all I gotta do is write a script. And it turns out, without the fluff, that a page is a lot longer than it seems. So that was difficult. And so I struggled with what story I was going to choose. Was it gonna be dramatic or comedic? And was I going to relate to something happening in the world? And where was the story going to start? And where would it end? And how would things change before the final line of dialogue? And so what I'm proud of is my dialogue. I've mentioned that a few times. I think it's pretty witty. I think it's pretty real. And yeah, I like it. And I like Jack, and I like his attitude. He's a little bit of an asshole. Excuse me, but he is. And I'm also proud of the tension that he has with the interviewer who's interviewing him about this what happened with his movie. And so I took a lot of inspiration from this scene. From it's my favorite movie scene of all time. So I hope you all like it too.
$69 cents. That's a guess.
Y'all getting any rain up here, man?
What way would that be?
I seen you was from Dallas.
What business is it of yours? Where I'm from? Friendo.
I didn't mean nothing by it.
Didn't mean nothing.
Just passing the time. If you don't want to accept that, I don't know. What else can I do for you? Maybe something else.
I don't know. Will there?
Is something wrong?
No, what?
With anything?
Is that what you're asking me? Is there something wrong with anything?
Will it be anything else?
You already asked me that. See about closing?
Yes, sir.
What time do you close?
Now. We close now.
No, it's not a time. What time do you close?
Generally around dark. At dark.
You don't know what you're talking about, do you?
Sir?
I said, you don't know what you're talking about. What time do you go to bed?
Sir?
You're a big time friend. I said, what time do you go to bed?
Somewhere around 9:30, I'd say around 9:30.
I could come back then.
Why would you be coming back? We'd be closed.
Yeah, you said that.
Well, I got to close now.
You live in that house on back?
Yes, I do.
You lived here all your life?
This is my wife's father's place, originally.
You married into it?
We lived in Temple, Texas for many years. Raised a family there in Temple. We'd come out of here about 4 years ago.
You married into it?
That's the way you want to put it.
Well, I don't have some way to put it. That's the way it is. What's the most you ever lost in a coin toss?
Sir?
The most you ever lost in a coin toss?
I don't know. I couldn't say.
Call it.
Call it, yes. For what?
Just call it.
Well, we need to know what we're calling it for here.
You need to call it. I can't call it for you.
Well, it wouldn't be fair. I didn't put nothing out.
Yes. You're dead. You've been putting it up your whole life. You just didn't know it. You know what day he sold this coin?
No.
1958. It's been traveling 22 years to get here. And now it's here. And it's either heads or tails. And you have to say, call it.
Look, I need to know what I stand to win.
Everything.
How's that?
You stand to win everything. Call it.
years then.
Well done.
Don't put it in your pocket, sir. Don't put it in your pocket, it's your money, water.
Where do you want me to put it?
Anywhere, not in your pocket. What will be mixed in with the others and become majestic on it? Which it is.
He's such a jerk, I love it. But anyway, so clearly, I mean, I don't know if you realize what he was hinting at. I hope you did. You didn't? Okay. He was hinting that he was going to kill the guy. He's a psychopath. He's a murderer, assassin, sort of guy that goes around killing people. And so basically, he was... But what goes along with that is a sense of superiority that I try to add into my character. And especially when he... When the guy keeps saying, sir, like, questioning him, he keeps repeating what he's saying, like he doesn't give an explanation. And then he calls the guy deaf when he keeps asking it. And he clearly, well, you know, being insane, thinks that he is better than this guy and smarter than this guy, which, to be fair, he is. But I just really love that scene because you can feel, like, the tension, like, as it goes on and on and on, and they have that conversation. And then he basically makes a lot of vague threats, and then the coin toss is sort of... The assumption is if the guy had called tails, he would have been shot in the head. So, lucky he didn't. Which is what I like so much about that scene, because there's anticipation to it. And I wanted my characters, you know, to sort of act in sort of a tense way like that when they're talking about this, especially Jack, when he's talking about this thing he doesn't want to talk about. So, I'm obviously nowhere on that level, but I'd like to read a little bit of something. And so... The interviewer, off screen, got it, I'm just here to guide you, don't worry too much about my input. Jack, oh, I was never too concerned about your input. Jack smirks a little as he looks at the interviewer to the right of the camera. So I guess, Jack continued, so I guess I'll try and give you guys the best story I've got. Sound good? Interviewer, off screen, good. Jack, yeah, good. Jack picks up the glass of water, takes a sip, and clears his throat. And this is sort of his, you know, he's being very theatrical about it. Jack continued, I wanted to be a big name, best of the best, the king. I wanted to strut my way down a red carpet and bask in the light of Oscar glory. I wanted to have my name and my movies up on all the theater boards all over. Jack Diamond in big black letters, surrounded by yellow lights. I can see it now. B. Jack continued, chuckles. Lofty goals, right? Interviewer off screen, I suppose, yes. Jack, I got a wide mindset. Interviewer off screen, or a big ego? Jack scratches the side of his face and looks to the right of the camera towards the interviewer. The uninspired, might call it that, B. So basically what I tried to do there was that sort of the first, I guess, taste of conflict between my two characters, because Jack is a much like the character in that movie is a jerk. And so he has a sense of superiority to the interviewer, even though he's, you know, a failed movie director. So I tried to add tension into that scene where he also sort of reveals his thoughts on other people and his standing in society. Okay. What I could use some work on is pacing. You know, I think my movie ends a little abruptly, and looking back, I'm proud of what I wrote, but I think that I spent a lot of time on longer scenes that when it ends, it sort of feels like it ends too soon. And so if I ever write another script, I will focus on that some. And then I also tonal inconsistencies. Like there's scenes where Jack talks about his family that are really emotional, and then there's more comedic scenes with just back and forth witty dialogue with the interviewer. And I did that because I wanted to try and fit in several different emotions to my story, but in a way it sort of made it worse, I guess, and so I'll work on that too if I ever write another script. And so where I started was I wanted to write a comedy. You know, I figured, okay, you know, jokes can be easy. The story to a comedy doesn't have to be that crazy complex. And so I figured it could either be outlandish and crazy and humor would have no bounds, or witty dialogue and smart jokes. And I also wanted a complex story with lots of impressive connections and some sort of dramatic revelation to show some purpose within the comedy. And I call that a I Am Your Father scene, because there's a scene in Star Wars where Darth Vader says, you know, I am your father, and it's like a big twist. I'm sure you all know about it. If you don't, you should watch the movie. I just gave away the twist, so maybe you know what happens. So, my bad. But anyway, that's a lot to try and put into a comedy, I think. You know, comedies can have depth, but for a first script, that would have been pretty impossible. Uh-oh. Okay, there we go. Okay, where I went. I realized that ideas needed to have legs because I had lots of little, ooh, fun idea, and then it would go nowhere, and I'd have to start the script over. And brainstorming can suck. It can really not be fun when you have this idea and you're like, yes, and then you can't go anywhere with it. And so I needed help with formatting, which also is really not fun, with pacing and with dialogue. And it was hard for me to just jump right in, and I, you know, needed some support. So I tried to do some outlining. I did some of that. That worked pretty well. And my script, I have my character. I mean, my first few things written on my script were Jack, movie director, and racist uncle. So that was interesting, and some of that stuff didn't fit into my movie. But I finally found a story. Okay. I've given you sort of what it's about a little bit. And so next I'm going to talk about who helped me out. And her name is Miss Miranda Rawson. She is a teacher and a screenwriter. And this is her little website. So she's got a movie she wrote on here. You can't really read the whole thing because that would not make any sense to post a whole script online. And then a television pilot, and then another pilot, and she's written some stuff. I haven't read any of it because she was helping me. I wasn't, you know, editing her scripts. And so where did I go? Okay. So. She helped me a lot with, you know, just general suggestions firsthand, like with different resources I could use. And then later on, I'll show you some of that later. So basically, she would talk to me a lot about outlining what I should do with that. And then she gave me resources, one of which is called Save the Cat for Screenwriting. It's a book. I forgot it at home, but it was very helpful. So if you're ever going to write a movie, I recommend using it. And then this app called Final Draft that I have on my computer, it's where I wrote my script. It was $200, but it helped a lot. And so, it was a good suggestion. I mean, there's nothing she could do about the $200 on the App Store. And then I had to read a lot about writing, like what makes good writing, how to write, stuff like that. And it was more interesting than I thought it would be, to be honest. And yeah, so those are some, she just sent me a lot of basically general ideas, and then those are her, I sent a lot of my scenes that she then edited. And so where I ended was, it's 40 pages long, like I said, there are only two characters in the entire script, but they talk more about other characters. And I think I have a lot of sharp and smart dialogue. I'm gonna continue to brag about it because I'm proud of it. And it's a more dramatic story than I anticipated, and knowing what I know now, I probably would have thought a little more before an application, but for an advanced study, but I'm glad that I did it because I learned a lot, and I got something I'm generally proud of. And yeah, I'd also probably try and research more script writing assistants because, you know, being sort of panicked, like, was it like 4 months ago, because I've been writing on Google Docs, that was pretty rough. And so I finally got Final Draft, and that helped a lot. Things went a lot quicker. Okay, so questions, I guess.
Yeah.
All right, Alex.
What made the Final Draft?
Okay, so I'll show you something. Just a little bit about what it does. Oh, that's
wrong. Oh!
Oh! My bad, guys. Okay. And a new scene. So, say I wanted Alex to say something. Alex is a character. He's not a nice boy. But, you get a character. Alex. Let's say I wanted him to be off screen. Uh-oh. OS is off screen. VO is voiceover that continues. Subtitle, interrupting, clarifying. Stuff like that. That's voiceover. So, he's saying something voiceover. Then you enter it, and then that's his dialogue. CBF is his dialogue, just in the typing thing. And then this is action. Alex kicks the soccer ball. Yay. That's action. So it's pretty easy, actually, once you get the hang of it. And then there's scene headings. So, interior. Alex's. So that would mean they're inside Alex's house tonight. And so it's pretty easy to use. That's probably, you know, it's really helpful, I guess. That's why it costs $200, I don't know. But yeah. Anything else? Yes, Elsie?
What's your favorite movie of all time?
Ooh, I forgot to mention that. So Miss Rawson also told me to read some scripts of movies that I love. And I love Three Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri. It's a great movie. You should watch it if you haven't. It's funny and dramatic and emotional, yada, yada, yada. And so the opening, particularly, is pretty funny. There's a lot of, there's especially that right there where my cursor is. That's a pretty funny line. And it was just, that I would say is my favorite movie. I read that script like 3 times during our process, and so I love it. It's a great movie, you should watch it. Okay, Ryan. That would be another $150 on my budget, so no, I did not, but I watched a lot of YouTube videos from different directors. Okay, Mike. I don't think anything's ever going to match my ambition, but I'm proud of it. Yeah, I would say it turned out pretty well. All right, Eli.
How was your time?
Well, I learned a lot about the actual, like, what makes a good script and, like, the process, like, researching how to write stuff like that before I actually started writing, so I'd say with that, my time management is pretty good. And script writing, once I started writing, I'd write for like 3 hours. And then I'd stop for like 2 days. And then I'd write for another 3 hours, and stuff like that. And then I'd go back and delete entire scenes that I'd spent hours on. And it was stuff like that. So I was a little rough with the time management, but I think I, you know, it turned out okay, so I'm here right now, I guess. L. Is that L? I have a hard time sharing my writing with people, but I don't think this is really something I want to go, this script particularly is something I want to go forward with. If I were to write something else, I would probably, the next step would be, you know, you have to find someone to connect you with different, you know, studio executives and stuff like that, and you have to pitch your story, and then if it gets picked up, you have to agree on, you know, payment, and then there's casting, and like I said, all the other filmmaking stuff. So, I'm just going to keep that on, because I like the light. But anyway, a lot of screenwriters don't make it because it's a really hard process. Most screenwriters don't make it, I should say. And so, yeah, I would probably, you know, if I were to move forward something, it'd have to be something I really think could mean something and could be a great film. And this one I like, but I'm not ready to share it with, you know, movie world. Hollywood. Yes. Why is it called a podcast? Well, oh, yeah. Okay. So, that's a good question. Thank you for remembering that. That means a lot, actually. But anyway, he called himself Jack Diamond because he sort of wanted to get away from his family. He was named after his dad, who sort of left when he was young. And he also hated his name. His name was Percy Frost, which is also a ridiculous name. And he wanted to be, he said he wanted to change his name to Jack, and this is the line. Well, I was pretty set on the name Jack, and if I kept my first last name, then I would have been named Jack Frost. Jack looks around the room as if he is surveying the documentary crew. He raises his arms, palm facing up, in a gesture signifying a question. Jack continued. I mean, we all see the problem with that, right? So, basically, it's got some personal aspects to it, but he also changed it because he thinks that he needs a more flashy name to make it in show business. So that's basically why. Thank you for remembering that, though. All right, anybody else? Mike again. Do I think I am basing the character off of myself? No, Mike, I understand. I would say a little bit, you know? You know, I mean, who doesn't want to win a big award for something that they enjoy and something that I guess... Except this is going to be something that I was going to drive the time. But anyway, I think I put a lot of my snarkiness and sarcasm into the character, but, you know, I dial up the insanity and the sort of egotistical behavior. So yeah, good question though. All right, anybody else? No, I don't see anyone. All right, I guess that's all.